गुड इवनिंग. ओके, आई एम ऑडिबल राइट? तो वी विल स्टार्ट. गुड इवनिंग. हाय गाइस, होप यू हैड फन विद मैथ. ओके, टुडे वी आर गोना डू रीडिंग कॉम्प्रहेंशन. सो यू मस्ट नो द पैटर्न ऑफ cat and you will know how important it is reading comprehension is for verbal sessions, and I think it carries around more than 10 questions in the cat exam, so you cannot ignore it and you have to concentrate on it. And let's do some sessions on it. And today we will try to understand what are the effective ways of reading the comprehension. So tell me, what is exactly reading comprehension? Do you know the meaning of comprehension? Yeah, comprehension itself is like clear reading, thorough reading, knowing the meaning of the passage, comprehending something to understand it thoroughly, correct? So reading comprehension is to understand the passage thoroughly. That is exactly what is important. You cannot just glance over the passage. You cannot just you cannot not understand the passage. You have to understand it thoroughly. Okay, so understand reading comprehension, and we will know about speed reading and effective reading. What is speed reading? Like, for example, when you go through a passage, you cannot just read by word by word, or you cannot be slow. That is exactly why you have to improve your... No, skimming is different. Skimming is very different from thorough reading. We will go through that. Skimming and scanning and all that. Tomorrow we will go through that. Today we will go through this. Okay? Speed reading, you cannot... See, skimming is something that you do on newspaper. Just you glance over it and you go through it. But speed reading with effective reading is what we are looking for. When you read a passage, it has to be fast. It has to be also effective. It cannot, for example, there is a sentence. But man is not destined to vanish. You cannot be like, but man is not. No, it has to be faster. And you have to do it inside your head. And it has to be quick. Sometimes the words you will come across may not know them, but it's okay. Don't be so afraid of new words. As we talked about the vocabulary session, we already know that. And by the context and by the gist of it, you will understand the passage. That's important. When you do not know particular words, just do not be so stumbled and be strict to that. No. You go through that and you understand the passage. That's important. For example, we will go through this. What is effective reading? Effective reading is more, as we said, to understand and to understand the details. There will be different kind of passages. Sometimes each passage has different requirement. For example, data-driven passages, like there will be 70%, 80%, 90%, then or numbers will be given in that passage. Some passages there will be like, you will have to read it thoroughly, because the most of the questions will be like info, decipher. What is info? Info is to interpret. What is your interpretation? What is your understanding of author's point of view? Video is paused. Oh. Okay. I don't know. It's clear for me. Is it like that for everyone else? It is clear. So, Aditi, I think check your internet. I think it is your net problem. Okay. So, what is reading comprehension? It requires you to answer based on the given passage. No external knowledge is required. This is really important, guys. You do not need any external knowledge. See, for example, when you do grammar part or when you do vocabulary, you have to know the meaning. You have to know the rules of grammar. You have to have external knowledge that you have to acquire from outside. Right? So, but in reading comprehension, you don't need that. Whatever you need, it's in the passage itself. And that's with you. It's actually very, very easy. That this session is very easy to score marks. Okay? If you master this, you will have like, it is high scoring session. Do not ignore this high scoring session. You don't even have to read anything else. You just have to have to know a particular strategies to read in a particular way. And for also you need to practice reading. Reading in general, the practice will make it better because that will actually help you in vocabulary. That will actually help you to comprehend, understand, to make you understand the session, sorry, understand the passage better, right? So as I said, I hope you are reading the newspaper. I mean, I will just assume that you are reading it every day. You know, I'm not asking you to give it like a lot of time, but just like just about 10 to 15 minutes if you can't find time. At least one, two articles, like editorial article or some other article. Read articles. Okay, that will help you. And also practice reading comprehension with me, and also after this session. Keep on practicing. That will improve your reading ability. And as I said, again, I'm emphasizing, you do not require any outside knowledge. So you have to concentrate on this to score high marks, right? Okay. Around 4 passages with a total 10 plus questions will be given. More than 10, I think it will be even higher. It's more like it is half of your verbal ability, almost. 30 to 40%, and it's not less, it is very high. Okay, important requirement, stay focused. What do I mean by stay focused? Stay focused as into, while you're reading a passage, you have to stay attentive and stay focused while reading. You cannot just be in a hurry to answer the questions. That's important. I will suggest you to do comprehension part in the beginning itself, because it requires you to stay focused. And the grammar and every other part and vocabulary, and so you have to do this first, because you have to have the time and also patience to read this. But do not be in a hurry, do not be in a very muddled mind and read it. Okay, so important requirement, stay focused. Okay, usually when we read, we read for three divisions. Like one we read for entertainment, one we read for learning, one we read to comprehend and solve questions. That's what we are gonna do. So reading to learn, I think we have done this all our life. You have done this in school, in college. And reading for entertainment, I don't know how many of you are doing it, because everyone is watching now Netflix and everything. But reading for entertainment is actually ideal. I'm not sure how many of you are doing it. Reading to comprehend and solve questions, that's what we are going to do today. And it requires what? If you are just reading for entertainment, or if you are just reading to learn, you don't have to look into the details, or you don't have to look for thorough reading. But this, it requires you to thoroughly check for the details, thoroughly. And some people read the questions first, then go for the passage. I do that. But since it is online exam, I'm not sure how far can you see the questions first. I don't think you can see the questions first. It will be passage, I think. But I always used to read the questions first, then go for the passage. Then I will know what I have to expect from the passage, and I will check the answers immediately. That is one strategy. But the ideal way, however, is to read the passage, thoroughly understand, then go for the questions. whoever is comfortable with whatever, I think you can go for it. But if it is, if you cannot see the questions first in your online exam, then you can't do that. You have to read the passage first. Correct? Okay. Okay. It requires you to read the complete paragraph and understand its main idea. What does it mean? A main idea. So there will be subject, there will be themes in a reading comprehension, in a passage given, right? So for example, in a movie, whatever movie that you watch, there will be some particular subject that it's talking about. What movie, anything, any Bollywood or any Tollywood, any movie that you can just think of, it will have a subject, it will have a theme. It will have all the elements like tone, mood. Is it a horror movie? It is a sad movie? Is it a fun, a comedy movie? Just like that, even passages will have the same. Okay, so you will have to understand the main subject of it. First, what is it talking about? What is it about? You have to know that first. Then you will understand it better to answer. When you are answering, it will really help you. Okay. Do you need to know the meaning of every word? Not really. You don't need to know the meaning of every word. Do not waste your time on that. That's like vocabulary session. If you improve your vocabulary, of course it will help you and you will understand words. But if you don't, everyone will come across new words. That's okay. You just have to go through that and be done with it and don't worry about the new words. Should you remember every sentence? No. You don't need to, because it's there. The passage is there with you all the time. You don't have to. You can go back and check it again. So you don't have to remember. You have to understand. That's important. Can I just do a light reading of the passage? No. Once, after you read it thoroughly, perhaps you can come back and do the scanning and skimming, those things. Maybe that is light reading. But at least once you have to read it thoroughly, you have to understand it. Okay? Okay. What is speed reading? So what are the do's and don'ts of speed reading? It's like read more words at a glance. When you read, you should read a sentence, not a word. You should not do a reading by word by word. That's what we talked about it already. So that's what you have to do. For that, again, you have to improve your reading skills and you have to read more. At least do it every single day. That will actually help you in three categories. That will help you in vocabulary, that will help you in speed reading, that will help you in even in general knowledge. Okay, read articles. Okay, pause at the punctuation marks. Pausing at the punctuation marks makes it even more clear. Sometimes when you do not pause at the right moment, for example, if you don't see there is a full stop there, you just go on, the sentence will not make any sense. You have to pause at the right moment. Then you will understand. And pausing, you don't pause just like, you don't sit and pause all the time, okay? Just pause at the right time and move on. That's what I mean, okay? Inhibitors, these are the don'ts. Word by word reading, don't. Don't, you have to, again, this is not school level, we have to do it sentence by sentence reading, even more if you can. Reading it aloud, see, this is not possible in exam hall anyway, but even while you are practicing, don't read it aloud. I mean, why? Because you waste a lot of time. For us, time is really important. Reading comprehensions, they will try to waste your time a lot, you know, with that. So if you read it aloud, you will concentrate on how to pronounce a word. If you do not know a word, how to actually read a word. And we are not being tested for our pronunciation of words, right? We are being tested for our comprehension skills. You don't need to read it aloud. Okay? Regression. Please don't go back and read it again and again. There is a difference. Okay, there is exceptions for this. When you read a passage, again you go back and read the passage. Again you go back and read two, three sentences you did because you didn't get it. try to avoid that. But you can, there are exceptions sometimes. If you don't understand, you can go back and read it. All I'm saying is don't waste your time. Your time is precious. Just while you're practicing also, time yourself. Always time yourself. How long are you taking to read the passage and solve the questions? Okay. So if you're going to regress, like go back and read it again and again, you're going to waste a lot of time. But if you read once with correct focused mind, you will understand the passage. You can go back to it. You can just skim and scan the passage for the answers when the time comes to answer the questions. Okay. Diversion. We have this habit. Whenever we read newspapers or when we read something else, we lose focus. We zone out. We often think about something else. I'm like, okay, what did I read? Okay, we'll go back. Don't do that. Even while practicing, at least, I know you won't do that probably in your exam hall, but don't do it at home also, because you have to stay focused. You have to get habituated reading such passages and answering. At least concentrate on that. Okay. So don't make your mind diverted. Just stay focused. Stay attentive to the passage while you're reading. Okay. Make notes for each paragraph. You can do this. Like when you read a passage, you can make a gist. You can either make pointers or make a gist or make a flow chart or visualize. These are the techniques. For example, if you are not very good at reading, if you're not very good at analyzing and understanding the passages, I will suggest you, in the beginning at least, you have to make a gist. Now, even in the exam hall, you can do that. You can just make a slight pointers, like what is it about? What is the main idea? What is it talking about? You can either make a flow chart or even pie chart if it is a data oriented passage. Okay, these are like ways for you to understand it better. When you write something, you will actually get into your, it will get into your brain. Okay, that's why we are asking you to make a note. Have pictorial representations if possible. If you are good at it, see, it's just scribbling. You don't have to make it like perfect picture or anything. No, it is all. We are all saying this because for you to understand it better, for you to have a proper visual, proper understanding of the passage. We are actually telling you to have draw something. For example, if they say Earth, meteor, or something, you just draw Earth or India, something like that. And draw states if they are mentioning any data in it. Okay. Example. Okay. Visualize. Yes. Some passages, they will make you visualize. Some they don't. If it is data oriented, if it has too many numbers, you don't have to visualize. But some passages will be required, you know, because we have to, it's like more story oriented. For example, if the author of the passage or the writer of the passage is talking about some greenery fields, what do you think about? You visualize, right? You visualize lush green fields. That's what I'm talking about. If you visualize, you will stay focused. You will be attentive. You will understand it better. Okay, try to get into that passage. Underline conjunctions and which express the change of idea help to make the connections. This is really important, guys. Why am I saying this? I said this during vocabulary also. Change of idea is very important. For example, rather, but, although, however, all these words will make it clear for you that there is a change of idea, change of pattern there. So you can easily comprehend the passage then. Whatever, you can't lose focus if you can concentrate on those particular conjunctions. That's why you have to stay focused. And similarly, although, however, all these conjunctions are really important. Infer and synthesize. Infer, what is inferring? Deciphering, inferring. The questions often vary, okay? There will be questions directly from the passage. For example, they will ask you, what is the year that it is taken from? So the year will be there. You can just go there and read the year and it will be done. And just answer the year. But sometimes they will be like, info, what is in the passage? Info. So they will be testing your comprehension, proper comprehension skills. What is inferring? Your understanding, what is it? What is the author's point of view? What is the mood of the passage? What do you think author will want from the passage? What do you think author is trying to tell you? Right? That is called infer and the synthesize. Synthesize is making it clear, okay? Step into author's shoes. This is what we talked about. And ask, what is the reason behind writing this paragraph? If you ask questions, there will be answers. You cannot just blindly read it. Okay, you will have to understand and answer question the author's intention behind writing that passage. Okay, identify the main idea points and study how the content is developed. See, often when we know what it is talking about, we will understand why such passage is written. For example, here you will go through that. We'll go through the examples, I think, next slide. We will discuss with the examples. Ask questions to search for answers behind any points made. Again, ask questions yourself. You will find the answers. You don't have to look for the questions itself, but you will ask yourself why the passage is written in the first place. And what is the main idea? What is the author even trying to tell you? Okay? You will have answers. We will do this. I'll give you like 30 seconds, not more than that, to read it and tell me what is this passage about, the main idea and the subject. Okay, we will read. I'll read once. Those who are not done, they can read with me. Okay, the fossil remains of the first flying vertebrates, the pterosaurs have intrigued paleontologists for more than two centuries. How such large creatures, which weighed in some cases as much as a piloted hang gliders and had wingspans from 8 to 12 meters, solved the problems of powered flight. And exactly what these creatures were, reptiles or birds, are among the questions scientists have puzzled over. Can you tell me the main idea of this passage? What is it talking about? I know there can be many words that are not, you know, you may not know what is paleontology, what is pterosaurs. It's okay. But can you like identify what is it talking about? What is the message? What is it about? I need answers. Yes, someone is typing. Okay. Interest behind pterosaurs. Okay. Oh, it's about the creatures. Yes. Okay, so pterosaurs. It's about pterosaurs. Good. And basically, it's about this creature that is dinosaur. Okay, one type of dinosaur. Fossils are usually that are the remains. If you go to the museum, you see the body structure of the dinosaurs and all that, right? That is fossils. So it's about the pterosaurs. And also, I can tell you it's about how paleontologists are talking about the paleontology is something that study of pterosaurs, fossils, and etc. They're talking about how the pterosaurs, even though they are huge creatures, they are huge creatures, even though they weigh a lot more than these piloted hang gliders. And they have about 10 to 12 meters like long wings and all that, still solve the problem of powered flight. There are scientists and paleontologists all are like puzzling over these facts. And another question they are puzzling over, they are like curious to know is what are these in the first place? Are these reptiles or birds? Reptiles are more like crocodile, alligator, a lizard and all those. The birds, are these birds? So these are like questions they are puzzled over. They are puzzling over. Okay. I want more answers. Okay. I want you to try to guess what is it about? What are they trying to draw? This is all about understanding the passages. I want you to be active. There is no wrong answer. We are all learning here. Please don't worry about, oh, am I saying a wrong answer? It's okay if you say a wrong answer. Okay, but I want you to answer. I want all of you to answer. Imagine a picture in mind or scribble on paper. For example, they said pterosaurs. Pterosaurs. What is it? It can be anything. You can just the fossil. It can you can draw a big heavy creature on paper for you to understand better. This is all for your understanding. Make symbolic representations. Like for example, there is like equal, better than, greater than, less than, all these mathematical symbols. You can do that. If they are talking about this is less than, this is more than, they are not equal. If you find such if you infer such things in the article, you just do that with mathematical, whatever helps you. I'm not saying do only this, but these are like methods to help you understand and also write it on your notes. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Interpret similes and metaphors. What are similes and metaphors? They are just comparisons. Well, they are just like when you are interpreting similes or she is like a lioness. He is a lion. When I say he is a lion, it is a metaphor. She is like a lioness. Like or as, if I compare it like that, it is a simile. You don't need to go into the details, but when such sentences are given, be careful. Try to understand what they are talking about. That can be tricky and tough, but focus and answer the question. Understand the analogies again. When they are comparing something, that's your clue. Are they comparing in a real sense? You will do the passages in the coming slides. You will see what is the comparison there. Are they really comparing and what are they comparing with? That's also very important. Okay, this. I want all of you to guess the main theme. Okay, then details. I'll give you 30 to 40 seconds. I'm giving you less time, right? But it's okay. You have to do it fast, so. Reading the first line itself, you have to know what is it talking about? You will know the subject the sooner you start. Okay, what is it about? Good, very good. Okay, so yes, very good. Even though someone answers, you can also answer. I just want you to know, I just want to know if you understand. Okay. Ocean basins, this is what they are talking about. And you can understand it by visualizing. So this is like okay. This is like the sea. And these are like ocean basins. You whatever works for you. Ocean basin is something that is lower than the ocean level, and a depressed level, something lower. Okay, whatever works for you, just make a visual representation and try to understand it. Yes, ocean basins. And why is it like it is. We can read once, okay. No very satisfactory account of the mechanism that caused the formation of the ocean basins has yet been given. The traditional view supposes that upper mantle of the earth behaves as a liquid when it is subjected to small forces for long periods, and that differences in the temperature under oceans and continents are sufficient to produce convection in the mantle of the earth, with rising convection currents under the mid-ocean ridges and sinking currents under the continents. So it's about how the ocean currents are forming. They're still trying to figure out the traditional view. So there are like two views. If you see this, there are like old view and the new view. The traditional view supposes that upper mantle of the earth behaves as a liquid, like the upper mantle of the earth, like this is ocean. Here it behaves as a liquid. Okay, when it is subjected to small forces for long periods, the differences in temperature under oceans and continents are sufficient to produce convection in the mantle of the earth with rising convection currents. So you have to, yes, there are many words that you may not understand in this passage, but it is okay. If you understand the main message, and you can go to the questions and read the questions two times, then you can come back to the passage. Whenever you see some unknown word, don't get rattled. Okay? Theme of the passage. Yes, theme of the passage is very important. What is it talking about? So you know this is about formation of ocean basins. At least that much you have to be very clear. The rest of it, you will understand it. The details of it, you can figure out. Okay? Predict. So predicting often helps. When you watch a movie, when you watch some thrillers or horror, or even in normal normal movies, you often predict like what's going to happen next, right? So when you do that with the passage, it will make you more attentive. It will make you more focused on the passage. What will happen next, or what will be discussed in the next paragraph? So that sometimes it will be like two or three paragraphs in the passage. You have to you can if you kind of develop this prediction thing, it will be more useful for you. That's what we are saying. Follow the clues. Again, there will be clues. You have to look for the clues. Guess. Guessing, not the answer guessing, but rather predicting. Predicting what's going to happen, predicting what it's trying to say, even before reading the next line. If you be that attentive, you will understand it much, much better. Check if you went wrong in identifying and interpreting clues. Sometimes we go wrong. That's okay. But go back and check why. If some question, if an answer is wrong, try to see why is your answer wrong? Where did you go wrong? What kind of interpretation could you have done better? Okay? Okay. So, read. And tell me, what is it about, the theme? And also, I will ask you one detailed question.
try to answer.
I'll give you 30 seconds. Okay, good. Good, okay. So the rest of, yeah. Yes, good. Yes, they are doing some research on meteorites. Good, good, good. Okay, so this is very good. Yes, okay. So this is like an important one. They have scientists, recently some scientists have concluded these are important, like, and there is an assumption or conclusion. You have to understand if it is an assumption or conclusion, especially in these scientist things. Is this a hypothesis or a conclusion? Is this an assumption or a conclusion? Oh yes, solution. That meteorites found on Earth and long believed to have Martian origin might actually have been blasted free of Mars gravity by the impact on Mars of other meteorites. So whatever that is on the Earth, that is that we can say that rock, we can conclude that rock is from Martian. It has a Martian origin. That is Mars, from the Mars. Martian is from the Mars. So this conclusion, this is important. This conclusion has led to another question. These kind of sentences are important. You will understand that there is another idea that is coming up. Whether the meteorite impacts on Earth have similarly driven rocks from, so whatever gravitation or whatever things that are on Earth might have driven these rocks to Mars. So this is another question that scientists have now. Okay, this conclusion has led to another question that is important. Good, all of you. Make connections between paragraphs. So the one conclusion led to another question. That is like making connection. Okay, can you connect the content in the passage with any movies, news, novels, and experiences? This again will help you to connect. For example, if you read the passage about meteorites, if you can think of any sci-fi movies, if you watch sci-fi movies, if you can just connect with that, you will connect it better. Yeah, okay. Whatever movie that you can think of, whatever movie in your personal life, it's not just sci-fi. In this passage, of course, it's only sci-fi movies, but anything that can connect, like novels, news, movies, experiences. Okay, can you develop a flowchart? Again, flowchart is not something that like perfect flowchart you have to make. No, it's like just something you have to write flowchart, and you have to just make like this and do some the pros and cons. This is pro, this is con. You have to just write like that. It will make it better. It will make you understand it better. For some people, it is. For some people, it may not be. If you find flowcharts difficult, don't do that. But if you can, it's a better way to do it. If you find visualization better, you can do that also. But connect with the passage. Okay? Okay, so this one, 30 seconds. You have to tell me the link between two paragraphs, not just a theme. Tell me the theme also, also link between two paragraphs. Okay. Poor funding, is it the theme? Or is it like, what is it about? What is the main subject? Okay. Suggestion to tackle the problem. Yes, good. Okay, the main idea is the problems with the archaeology. Yes. Good. Good. Yes. The problems and the solutions. Yes. So we will do it. Archaeology as a profession faces two major problems. Yes, it is like the problems and the solutions kind of passage. First, only paltry sums are available for the excavating, and even less is available for publishing and the results and preserving the sites once excavated. Yet, archaeologists deal with priceless objects every day. Second, there is a problem of illegal excavation. Good. Yes. I would like to make an outrageous suggestion that would at one stroke provide funds for archaeology and reduce the amount of illegal digging. Illegal digging is illegal excavation. Okay. So, yes, you're all right. There are like two problems. Can I just write it here? Archaeology. There are like, okay, I can't. Archaeology, there are like two problems. What is one problem? Money. And another problem? Illegal digging. So you can just write like this. So you will understand there are two problems. And what is this? Solution. You can just like make it a solution. What are the, can you guess what will be the next passage, next paragraph in this passage? It will be there like, they will be suggesting solution in detail, right? He said, yes, yeah, you're gonna do that. So it is like outrageous suggestion. Yeah, opinion, solution, they are gonna talk about the solution in detail in the next coming paragraph. You can predict that, correct? We can predict that. Yeah, that's good. Okay. What is the main theme of the passage? What are the supporting and opposing points? Like, and there will be sometimes argumentative passages where will some points will be supporting the idea, some points will be opposing the idea. You have to be clear of that. Okay. What are the places and objects and symbols groups discussed in the passage? And this will be, there are factual data-based factual passages where it will be very helpful. You don't have to remember, but just note, underline or notice those places, objects, symbols, groups discussed in the passage. Usually there will be at least one question or will be factual. See, there will be inferring questions and there will be factual questions. Never miss on the factual question. It's just like going into the passage and finding that word and writing the answer, correct? Never miss on it. What is the meaning of a particular word? Sometimes it's important. And what sometimes the word hypothesis, for example, you have to know what is hypothesis. it's assumption. It is like an assumption. It is not conclusion. You have to know, but if you don't know, don't waste time on that. Just read the passage and go through that. You will know. Okay? Don't waste your time. And sometimes when the cat will be like this, there will be tough passages. There will be okay passages, mediocre problem, moderate, normal passages. There will be very easy passages. Okay? So when it is a tough passage, don't waste so much time on that. You will be regressing back. You cannot understand. You will be going back. You will try to comprehend. You will try to answer. You will be wasting a lot of time. In the meanwhile, you can do at least two other passages. First, do the easier passages. If you first start reading, if you cannot do it in one go, go for the other passages and come back to it again later. Don't waste your time. What is the tone or mood of the passage? This is like, again, we talked about, there will be mood and tone of the tone for everything. And sometimes that helps. And these scientific passages, you will know if it is supporting the idea or if it is opposing the idea. By that, you will know it is sad or happy or just, is it criticizing or is it praising? Right? Okay. Okay, read now. 30 to 40 seconds. Okay, I think Aditi is correct. Yeah. Okay. So we'll just, yes. This is about what seniors managers do, like the strategies and the methods they follow. Are they following the traditional methods? Are they following any new methods? Are they following any method at all? Okay. We'll see. The majority of the successful senior managers do not closely follow classical rational model of the first clarifying goals, assessing the problems. These are like the examples: clarifying goals, assessing the problems, formulating options, estimating likelihoods of success, making a decision. Okay, then only taking the action to implement decision. These are all examples. Rather, change of idea. Okay. Rather, in their day by day tactful maneuvers, these senior executives rely on what is vaguely termed as intuition. What is intuition? Like, it's like instinct. You do by your own intellect, you do by your own thought process. You don't depend on some strategy. To manage a network of interrelated problems that require them to deal with ambiguity, inconsistency, novelty, surprise, and to integrate action into the process of thinking. Like, if I, now you understand, right? It's like the traditional method or new method. Are they following it? And they're just going by the intuition. They are not following this classical or conventional traditional method. Okay. Now, if I ask, like, what are the senior managers doing with intuition? what are the kind of problems they are solving. Now you can say ambiguity, inconsistency, novelty, surprise. They're all trying to do by the instinct and intuition. They're trying to solve the problems with that. And what are the classical rational model and what are the kind of acts and models that you can do with classical rational model? You can say these examples. Okay, if you understand the passage here, you can actually answer any question easily and you can go to the word and answer it. Okay. Focus on the transition words. Identify the change of ideas. There in that passage, rather is the change of idea. You have to understand that. Immediately you have to catch that. Okay, rather. So there is like a change of idea. Okay, there is a however. There is like a change of idea. You have to know that. Simplify, rephrase the sentences to avoid ambiguity. Often there will be tricky and long passages. It's just to waste your time. You can just simplify it. If you can make it just, I think this will help. If you try to make it just of the passage in just like 2-3 points, you will easily simplify also. Try to do that in practicing while practicing at home. Just try to make it just or pointers for 2-3 pointers, not more than that. And try to see what is the subject and try to simplify a sentence. Okay, then you will understand it better. If sometimes with the commas and there will be a long sentence, you don't have to worry about it. Just simplify it. It will be like this. You don't have to worry. Okay. Have clarity about author's idea. This is important. Again, this is like the subject. What are they talking about? Okay. And sometimes author point of view will be tricky. In coming passages, we will see why. Okay. Read this. Okay, good. More? What is it about? Okay. So this is about the great migration in the history. Yes, it is talking about the migration that happened in the history. Is it like concluded? Yeah, no. It has been frequently assumed. This is not proved, but not proved. Yes, good. Okay, good. It has been frequently assumed but not proved that the majority of the migrants in what has come to call the Great Migration came from rural areas and were motivated by two concurrent factors. So this colon is like, what are the factors? They're going to say this colon suggests that the collapse of the cotton industry following the boll weevil infestation, which began in 1898, and the increased demand in the north for labor following the cessation of European immigration caused by the outbreak of First World War in 1914. So, there are two reasons given. There are two reasons assumed. Infestation, cotton, the insects come and spoil the cotton field, right? Infestation. That is called infestation. It's ruined, sort of. Okay. Increased. There are like three suggestions given. Three reasons given and assumed. Sorry, these are not proved. They are assumed. What are the reasons? You can just point out one reason, two reason, three reason. You can just write it so that you will know, and you can answer it better. Look at the pieces of information given and study the adjective and adverbs. Why adjectives and adverbs? They will tell you the mood. For the tone and mood, often adjectives are very important. They'll be like, they'll tell you what is the mood and tone of the passage. Interpret the numbers given. When some numbers are given, interpret them. Again, make important note on them. Again, you don't have to remember, but understand them. Analyze the comparisons done. Okay, we'll see. There are this is data-based, factual passage. It should be easier. Okay, read. Okay, but primarily it talks about one thing while comparing with others. Yes, it is. It talks about clerical workers while comparing with others. Yeah, clerical workers. Good. Okay. In 1977, 34% of the government clerical workers were represented by a labor organization, compared with, you have to know this is the main theme then. These are other compared percentages and all that. But the main theme and main subject is clerical workers. Compared with 46% of the government professionals, 44% of the government blue collar workers, 41% of the government service workers. Since then, however, the biggest increases in the public sector unionization have been among clerical workers. Okay, between 1977 and 1980, the number of unionized government workers in the blue collar and the service oriented increased only about 1.5%, while in the white collar occupations, the increase was 20%, and among clerical workers in particular, the increase was 22%. Okay, so what is it about? They are telling us
Well, can you see the change of idea somewhere?
Can you identify the change of idea, like however, or something like that? Yes, good. So this one, this is like change of idea. Why? Until then, so in the starting in 1977, it's only the clerical workers were only like 34% represented by labor organization. Okay, but they were gradually unionized. However, the biggest increases in public sector unionization have been among clerical workers. Because of that, 1977 and between 1980, the service occupations increased only, like other occupations increased only like little bit, but the clerical workers increase was huge. It's about 22%. Okay, so the clerical thing, it started with very less number. Compared with others, they were like 44%, 41% later, but in the meanwhile, it changed. Yes, maximum increase. Okay, good. So now we will do exercises. After you get a basic idea of the passage, confirm the accuracy of the interpretations to avoid any misinterpretations or coming to erroneous conclusions. Going back and reading multiple times is not good, but confirming before solving questions is needed. Don't read multiple times, but you can of course go back and confirm, check for the answers in the passage. Okay? This is, we are doing the exercise now. You have the PDFs, right? Yeah, we also have the PDFs here. You can take the PDFs also. It will be easier. You can see the options also there. But read the passage first. I'll give you about 2-3 minutes to read the passage. Then we will read once. Then you can do the questions again. I will give you time again. Okay, you are done. Okay, once we will read, we will do the questions. But man is not destined to vanish. He can be killed, but he cannot be destroyed because his soul is deathless and his spirit is irrepressible. Therefore, though the situation seems dark in the context of confrontation between the superpowers, the silver lining is provided by amazing phenomenon that the very nations which have spent incalculable resources and energy for the production of deadly weapons are desperately trying to find out how they might not never be used. They threaten each other, intimidate each other, go to the brink, but before the total hour arrives, they withdraw from the brink. Okay? You will do the questions now.
What is the main point from author's view?
Okay. Okay. So what is happening here? You have the PDF, right? Just go back to the passage again. Since you are giving a lot of different answers, we will see why such different answers have come up, not one. The main point from the author's view is that, so here you just can't go by the words. You have to understand. That's where we have talked about. What is it saying? What is the passage saying? You cannot kill humans. You can create as many nuclear bombs you want, but ironically, you will try to not use them. You cannot destroy man's spirit. That's what it is talking about. And humanity will never be dead, how many wars ever be fought. Great wars. That is what it is talking about. It is not just like this. The soul and spirit cannot be destroyed by superpowers. Yes, it may seem like an answer, but if you understand, human society will survive despite the serious threat of total annihilation. What is annihilation? It's like being destroyed, like nuclear threat. We have nuclear, now we are on the verge of a war with China, right? So why is this, you can think this as an answer, but it is more appropriate. D is more appropriate. I'll tell you why. Man's soul and spirit cannot be destroyed by superpowers. What superpowers? Yes, they use this superpowers in the passage, but in what context? Confrontation between the superpowers. The silver, so basically it's the nations. Yeah, nations and here in the context, superpowers is nations. And like, for example, China, India, in India right now. That's what the superpowers in the context of passage is. It's not like superpower as in God or something. Okay? Man's destiny is not fully clear, or that's not. Okay, correct. Man's soul and spirit are immortal. Yes, that is the point. Yes, I agree. But the whole point of the passage is not that. He's not just saying that man is immortal and his spirit cannot be destroyed. Why? It cannot be destroyed even though there is a threat. Even though you can create how many wars you want, how many possible threats you want. Like, for example, and the very nations which have spent incalculable resources and energy for production of deadly weapons are desperately trying to find out how they might never be used. So it is about the threats, correct? Do you see that? Well, three possible answers are here, A, C, D, but D is the more appropriate answer. Not that C and A are not correct. Yes, they are probably correct, but superpowers here, it doesn't make any sense in this options. But in the passage, it is more like nations. Spirit cannot be destroyed by nations is not the correct answer. Here, C can be an answer, but C is like just a generalization. We are not talking about this generalization if we do not have the option of D. If there is no option of D, perhaps I would have chosen C. But D is more appropriate. Because even in the last line, they threaten each other, go to the brink, but before the total arrives, they withdraw from the brink. Okay? Okay, clear? Since many of you have given different options, I want to see, I mean, how do we choose the answer? Clear? Yes? Okay. This one. Okay. The phrase "go to the brink" in the passage means what is going to the brink? Okay, this is where you get confused, guys. Read the passage once again. Since you're new to this, read the passage once again, because they will confuse you like this. And they will confuse you because two answers can be right, but one is more appropriate. Read it again.
We have the brink line especially. Where is the brink line?
They threaten each other, intimidate each other, go to the brink, but before the total hour arrives. But before the total hour arrives, they withdraw from the brink. What is in the context of the passage? What are we talking about? Nuclear weapons and all that. You have to understand in the context of the passage. Yes, retreating from extreme danger is the meaning of the brink, correct? But in the passage, going to the brink is declaring war on each other. That's what the passage is trying to say. Read it again in the context. We will do it slowly since it is new because the options are very confusing for you. Okay, let's go slowly. Okay. Okay. The very nation has spent incalculable resources and energy for production of deadly weapons. Why do we create deadly weapons? For war. They are talking about war. How many wars ever you create, you fight, we are going to live on. And desperately trying to find out, they might never be used. They threaten each other, intimidate each other. They meaning the nations. Go to the brink. In the passage, they threaten each other, intimidate each other, and go to the brink, declare war on each other, go to the extreme. Okay? You're all concentrated on retreating, but not engaging. Going to the brink is not that. Okay? Retreating is different. Going to the brink is going to the extreme. They are talking about the war here. That's why they can't be an answer. We are not talking about retreating here, not engaging. Going to the brink is going to an extreme. In like normal sense. In this context, going to war on each other. In the normal, brink is an extreme. Brink meaning is extreme. Okay? That's why A and C cannot be the answers. Extreme danger can be an answer, but retreating is not the one, especially. Advancing to stage the war is the answer, but not engaging in it is not the answer. These parts, okay? You have to understand why the options are, other options are not answers, especially since you have chosen. That's important. That's why I'm emphasizing. Clear? Going to the brink. Going to an extreme. The next passage. Take 2 minutes. It's okay in the beginning, we make mistakes. It's difficult, especially in the CAT level, they often give you confusing options, like the two or three can be possible answers, but one word, slight word, can be different. That's where you get it gets tricky. You have to choose the better one. It's okay. Take time. You will find your pace and then you will answer it better. Two minutes.
You can read from PDF, because I'm not sure where it is.
Okay, we will see.
I'm done.
The hypothesis never attracted notable support. Something did not attract notable support. So we know that. If it were not for the historical example of continental drift, such indifference might be legitimate. However, the drift too was once illusory, but the idea alive, physicists compelled dangerous to overreact. The cases are not precisely analogs. What cases? We will see. If, however, physicists could show that Earth's gravitational force has decreased with the time, expansion would have to be reconsidered and accommodated. I think we'll do from the exercise. It reduced reading. That's just a second. This one is better. Once I'll read the one again. So if it were not for the historical example of continental drift, such indifference might be an illegitimate response to an apparently improbable concept. It should be remembered, however, the drift too was once regarded as illusory. But the idea was kept alive until the evidence from the physicists compelled the geologists to interpret their idea, their data. Of course, it would be as dangerous to overreact to history by concluding it must now be wrong about the expansion as it would be to reenact the response that greeted the suggestion that the continents had drifted. The cases are not precisely analogs. This is important. There were serious problems with the pre-drift view that a drift theory could help to resolve, whereas Earth expansion appears to offer no comparable advantages. If, however, physicists could show that the Earth's gravitational force has decreased with time, expansion would have to be reconsidered and accommodated. Okay. Yes, it is a little tricky. Yes, it is a tough passages, but we have to get used to doing such passages. Okay. None of you have started except, of course. Okay. 3B, we will see. Rest of you, we will do the questions now. The passage indicates that one reason why the expansion hypothesis has attracted little support that is that it will not. Can you tell me what it is talking about first? What is the subject of the passage now? It's given in the very first sentence itself. Subject. What assumption? What is it talking about? Okay.
So there are two concepts in the passage.
One is continental drifting and another is expansion of Earth. Two theories. Okay. The first one is expansion.
Okay. Expanding Earth, the thesis of
theory. This is theory. Expanding Earth. Another theory is continental drift. He is in the beginning comparing. Okay. He's comparing. Since everyone is comparing, he's trying to talk in the terms of it. Okay. So what is he saying? Basically the expansion theory. There is a theory that Earth will expand in time, but the theory is improbable. It's not proven. It's just an assumption. So it's not getting a lot of support from scientists. Why? I will tell you later. But not for the historical example of continental drift.
After a point, the continents will drift apart.
Have you seen this movie, Ice Age? Animation movie, then you see continental drift. The continents will be drifted apart. That is the theory. That is, at one point, even that theory was not accepted. But they thought it was just like improbable theory. But it was proved right. Okay, so he's saying this can be compared with this. So if it were not for the continental theory, the theory of expansion of Earth will be. Okay. Everyone is saying C. We will see. Okay. So first, do you understand the message? You understand the message, right? the subject of the passage. The passage indicates that one reason why the expansion hypothesis, this is the hypothesis we are talking about, has attracted little support. So it did not attract support. The reason is, everyone is saying complement the theory of
why? No. So why do you think complement the theory of continental drift? Did you read the passage?
I will ask you to read it again.
This has nothing to do with continental drift. He's just comparing. He's even saying the comparison is not required. Look at this sentence. The cases are not precisely. Okay. Analogs. So what cases? One is expansion theory, another is drift theory. These two theories are not precisely comparable. He's saying that. Okay? Everyone is telling that, they are compared.
So since drift theory was once accepted, this expansion theory could also be a given chance.
No. He's saying they're not comparable.
So the C is not a correct answer, guys. It has nothing to do with the continental drift.
Another one.
We will see. Overcome deficiencies in current geologic hypothesis. We will see where is the first one answer. There were serious problems with pre-diff world. Okay, this is not. Whereas Earth expansion appears to have no comparable advantages. Number three. This is the answer for number three. Why? It did not gain any support from the scientists because it does not do anything for Earth. It does not have any advantage. We do not gain anything from the theory.
That's what it is saying.
It did not gain any support. Overcome deficiencies in current geologic hypothesis. So what we have, whatever questions we have about Earth, they don't really solve with this expansion theory. So this can be a possible answer. We will see the next one. Clarify theories concerning the Earth's gravitational forces. This can also be an answer. Clarify theories. It does not clarify the theories about gravitational forces, but majorly it does not clear anything. It does not provide any solution for the Earth problems that we are facing today. Okay, so this has to be the better answer. We'll see D also. Accommodate relevant theories from the field of physics. No, this cannot be the answer. This one. Geologic is more like Earth related. This is not geology. We are not talking about geology. Okay. This has to be the answer. Read it once again. Whereas Earth expansion appears to have no comparable advantages.
It provides no advantage.
The final acceptance of a drift theory could best be used to support the argument that. What is the answer? Just write 4, because I cannot figure out if this A, B, C, and are 3 or 4. Yeah, 3 of course. 4, C or B, something like that, yeah.
Good.
The final acceptance of a drift theory. See, you have to go back to the first lines.
Talking about the drift theory, continental drift. It should be remembered, however,
the drift too was once regarded as illusory. But the idea was kept alive until the evidence from physicists compelled the geologists to reinterpret their data. So what is the conclusion of drift theory? What did it prove? Okay, so Fourth one is your.
Correct. Okay. We will see. Physicists are reluctant to communicate with other scientists. Not really. I mean, they did not mention that. Improbable hypotheses usually turn out to be valid.
See,
if it's written sometimes, I would have chosen this. Okay, but it is written usually, which means every time there is a theory which is not accepted turns out to be right. It's not the case. The passage did not suggest that. So this is also wrong. Okay, now there should be cooperation between the different fields of science. We can infer from the passage, especially since the first paragraph, we can infer from the passage that geologists and physicists, everyone should cooperate with each other. This seems to be the answer. If because compared to other options, this seems to be the better answer. There is a need for the governmental control of science. This is not at all written in even in the passage, so this is not the answer. Okay. Next one, fifth one. Good. Okay, good. So in the beginning of the passage, there seems to be like comparison. You shouldn't be tricked by that. Like, he seems to be comparing drift theory and expanding theory himself, but he says that people are doing that. Since people are comparing the two theories, they are considering expansion of the earth theory, but later he says they shouldn't be compared. Correct. So that's why the D is the answer. Since everyone said D, okay. No, C, rejecting corroborative evidence. Okay, we are not talking about the evidence though here. Making on it suggests, the author warns against. The author warns against making unnecessary comparisons. Every theory is different. You don't have to compare. Okay. Relying on incomplete measurements, introducing irrelevant, these are not mentioned at all. Rejecting corroborative evidence, these are not mentioned in the passage. It's the only one that is mentioned. See, this can be correct if it's not for this passage. We need to always look for what is written in the passage. Our scope is in the passage. Do not go outside of the passage. Okay. It can be deduced from the passage that the gravitational force at a point on Earth's surface is. Okay. More. I want to say more. Read the last lines. Last lines. Deduced. What does deduced mean? Understood. Deciphered. Yeah. Interpreted. So it's not exactly written, but we interpret as it to mean. So it can say, it's saying that. Okay. So what is it? Last lines, we are just reading it. If, however, physicists could show the Earth gravitational force has decreased with time, expansion would have to be reconsidered and accommodated. Okay. Read this once. It can be deduced from the passage that the gravitational force at a point of Earth's surface.
So basically representative to the geologic age of the earth? Not really. No, nowhere is it mentioned. No, this is wrong. Analogs to the movements of land masses? See, it's not mentioned in the passage. This can be somewhere else, but not in the passage. It's not given. Okay, then we have to interpret from the what is analogs to the movement of masses. That is like another theory. That's not mentioned at all. Similar to optical phenomena as mirages, no, it's not mentioned. What is proportional to the size of Earth? Gravitational force. Gravitational force proportional to the size of Earth. Read the last line again. Gravitational force decrease with time. If they can prove gravitational force, there is a connection between the size of Earth and gravitational force. That's what they're talking about. If, however, physicists could show that Earth gravitational force has decreased with time, expansion would be like if the Earth is expanded, if the gravitational force decreased, and there couldn't be possible, this theory can be possible. So this is what it suggests. Okay, next one. We are taking a lot of time. Okay, next one, guys. Passage 3. I'm giving you 2 minutes. We have done the line, right? Super. Minutes. Okay, you don't have the PDF? I mean, I'll have to. No? Okay. Fine, okay. Just read until then, step by step. Tell me then, I'll scroll it. The rest of you have the PDF, right? Do it from the PDF. It will be easier for you to just scroll. Yes. Do it from the PDF. This is relatively easier. I'm scrolling down. Okay. Okay, we'll read once. Shall I read once? Okay, just read along with, read with me if you haven't done, if you haven't finished. Insatiable curiosity is one of the most important characteristics of human mind. From the earliest days to the present time, man has observed and wondered and been ill at ease until he has found the satisfactory explanations of natural phenomena. Every primitive person has these explanations. However fantastic they may seem to us, they are nevertheless just as reasonable as our own when the consideration is given to the limited experience and the knowledge on which they are based. These primitive explanations of natural phenomena are no sooner formulated than they begin to be modified by further experience. Here are the beginnings of philosophical and religious speculations of science. Religious speculation is primarily concerned with unknown. Philosophical speculation is with the projection of the known into the unknown. The science with the known. The early progress of the science is excessively slow. The power of tradition is great. The power of tradition is great, and old beliefs give way but slowly to the new ideas. Step by step, however, naturalistic ideas make inroads upon the field and pure imagination. There is never ceasing conflict between tradition and new knowledge. The field of known is ever increasing, but the unknown ever extends limitless beyond. Some minds find satisfaction in the known. Some are chiefly concerned with the unknown, but apparently noble borderland. Some find compelling fascination in the further distances of the unknown, where imagination can have free play. Oh, Aditi, okay. See, the thing is, those who are doing the first classes can just ask in the institute to have the previous classes. This is the first reading comprehension class, so this is new to everyone. But the first sessions, you can ask and take permission from the institute. I think they will give you password or something. And take the recorded classes, that are vocabulary recorded classes, you can watch them. Okay? Maybe that's why you don't have PDF, right? I think, okay, we will see. The reason for man's ill ease has been. Someone is saying D, someone is saying A. Okay. Okay, so one second, guys, sorry. Okay, those who are new to this program, I think can check the Telegram. They will guide you, okay? The reason for MALS, this pen is not working now. Sorry about that. We will see. The reason for MALS ill ease has been. Why do you think is the curiosity? Read the first line again. The insatiable curiosity is one most important characteristics of the human mind. Correct. Okay. But what is ill at ease? Here it is mentioned. See that. Man has observed and wondered and been ill at ease until he has found satisfactory explanations. Yes? Ill at ease until he has found satisfactory explanations. You have the answer in the passage itself. You don't even have to inform. What is the answer now? B. B is the answer. Correct. I'm trying to make my pen work. This is not working. Okay. The primitive's explanation seem rational as 8. It's pretty straightforward, guys. Okay. His obsession with natural phenomena. See, in the passage, it's like given. Ill at ease until he has found satisfactory explanations of natural phenomena. Yes. But then it has also been given satisfactory explanation. I'll just tell you wait. The question is, what is the question? The reason for man's ill at ease has been his need for satisfactory explanation, his obsession is there like obsession? Did they talk about obsession in the passage? Hey, it has come back. Yes, this one. So it's not B, C. Why? Because in this word, you have to be very particular about words. If it is used in the passage, it's okay. But if it's not used, it's not gonna, you can't say it is that the man has obsession. He has curiosity, insatiable curiosity. That is established. But there is no mention of obsession. Okay? The primitive's explanation seem rational as they, okay, so people are saying they are founded on limited. Yes, correct. This is the one. They are not, it's given in where? Where is it given? Limited experience. Oh, yes. Correct? Okay. Just check for the answers. Immediately scan the passage, skim through the passage, and then you will find one. Yes. According to the passage, modifications are an indication of. What are they an indication of? 9. Good, very good. Yes. Why is it C? See, it's not natural calamities. Of course, it's not mentioned. It's not our expanding knowledge. This is not experience. If it is experience, they have mentioned about expanding experience, but this is knowledge. So it is not correct. So they have mentioned about philosophy and science. So yes, this is the answer. Scientific speculation, it's not mentioned. It's mentioned in which line now? Here are the beginnings of philosophical. Sorry. Yes. These are the lines. These are the lines. Here you can find the answer. Okay. The 10th one. The main difference between philosophical speculation and science is 10th one. Okay, read it again. Is it really C? Read it again. Read the lines. Where is it written? Okay. Correct. Okay. So basically, the philosophical speculation is more to do with known into the unknown. Correct? In the passage, the science is concerned with known. Known into the unknown. The exact line is given in the passage, guys. Check it. It's not speculation concerned with the known. It's not that. It's not correct. Why? Because it's unknown into the unknown. It's mentioned. Science is concerned with known as well as unknown. No, it's not mentioned. Speculation, this is to confuse you. Unknown into the known. They mentioned known into the unknown. Okay. This is the answer. Just check the passage once. Okay, read the lines. Okay. Minds are fascinated with the distance of unknown because good. Okay, you got the PDF. Good. Read the last line. Minds are fascinated with the outside unknown horizons. Why? Yes. Yes. Good. Good. Everyone is right. Correct. I don't have to explain this, right? The last line itself is like a self-explanatory. Yes, last line is the answer. Imagination can have a free play. Okay. So since we have less time, you can do fourth one. I think seventh one is really important. It has like the fourth one only has three questions. Fifth one. What is the fifth one? Let me see this. Okay, we will do fifth and seventh, okay? The rest you can do at home, as in your own time. Fifth one. We'll do fifth and seventh. The rest you can do later. We don't have time, okay? Two minutes. Okay, good. You have started it. So, okay, I'll just quickly read it. The ancestor of the modern horse lived just after the dinosaurs dominated the earth. It was not too bigger than a rabbit. It lived in forests. It was named. Okay, everyone is really fast. I don't even have to read it. I like it. Okay, I will not read it then. The time is also. We just have 5 minutes. What is the passage about? Good. Evolution of the horse. Yes. Very good. It's not the. It's not just pre-medieval, or it's not just the structure of the particular horse. It's about evolution, comparing the medieval and also modern, how it evolved. Okay. What does the word species mean in the paragraph? Yes. Very good. 16A. Category of animals. Not a flock of animals. Not a skeleton. Not a gender. When they talk about species, I think they mentioned it twice in the passage. I think they mentioned it twice. Twice in with referring to the horses. Horses are animals. Okay. How are the horses at the end of the dawn period? Okay. How are the houses at the end of the dawn period like the modern houses? They go. Yes, good. Okay, just let me see that. Let me just go through them slowly. You are all going so fast. Yes. I'll try to answer for the rest of the people, okay? Answer it properly. Till line till answer, okay? Finish it till answer. Yeah. This line is mentioned in the passage. Where is it mentioned? See, when you see such lines, just go through the one passage and quickly glance over it and see the answer. It even mentioned that only one toe had touched the ground. Okay. Any doubts in this? The other things are not mentioned, at least not emphasized as this one. Okay, any doubts in this question? No. I'm not explaining the other options. Why is the ancestor of the horse named the Dawn Horse? It's mentioned in the first paragraph, in the first few lines. 18th question. Correct. This is mentioned. In the first paragraph, guys. Like, not in the first few lines. What enabled the ancestors of the horse to live in open plains? Okay. Sorry. Correct. Very good. Aditi, okay. Yes. Alekia, yes. Good. All of you. Morana, yes. Okay. So this one. They again mentioned in the last but one part, I think. You can see the last one, right? So yes, you are deciphering well. You are actually reading it well. I'm happy. So we'll do the last one because it's a little tricky. You can do the rest of them later. Okay. Last one, seventh one. It's related to data. Minutes. We'll just do till 9:10. Okay. There are okay. Okay, good. Recent years have brought minority-owned business in the United States unprecedented opportunities, as well as new and significant risks. Civil rights activists have long argued that one of the principal reasons why Blacks, Hispanics, and other minority groups have difficulty establishing themselves in business is that they lack access. This is an important line. I'll just mark the important lines. They lack access to sizable orders and subcontracts that are generated by the large companies. Now, Congress, in apparent agreement, that has required by the law that business awarded federal contracts of more than $5 lakh do their best to find the minority subcontractors and record their efforts to do so on forms filled with the government. Indeed, some federal and local agencies have gone so far to set specific percentage goals for opportunity to goals for apportioning parts of public works contracts to minority enterprises. Corporate response appears to have been substantial. So it's good. Corporate response has been good. According to the figures collected in 1977, the total corporate contracts with minority businesses rose from 77 million in 1972 to 1.1 billion in 1977. The projected total of the corporate contracts with minority businesses for the early 1980s estimated to be over 53 million per year, with no let-up anticipated in the next decade. Promising as it is, the minority business, this increased patronage poses dangers for them too. First, minority firms expanding too fast and overextending themselves financially, since most of them are small. Most of them are small concerns, unlike the large businesses. They often need to make substantial investments in the new plant staffs, equipment, like in order to perform work. See, what are they trying to say? You got the one, right? What is it about? Guys, only Arjun seems to answer the questions. I want you to tell me what is the theme of the passage. What is it about first? I'll keep reading. If thereafter their subcontracts are some for some reason reduced, such firms can face potentially crippling and fixed expenses. The world of corporate purchasing can be frustrating for small entrepreneurs who get requests from for elaborate formal estimates and bids. Both consume valuable time and resources, and a small company's efforts must soon result in orders, or both morale and financial health of the business will suffer. A second risk is that the white-owned company may seek to cash in the increasing apportionments through formation of joint ventures with minority-owned concerns. Of course, in many instances, there are legitimate reasons for joint ventures. Clearly, white and minority enterprises can team up and acquire business that neither could acquire alone. But civil rights groups and minority business owners have complained that the Congress and the about the minorities being set up as front. This is important. Fronts with the white backing rather than being accepted as full partners. They are not being accepted as full partners in legitimate joint ventures. Okay. Guys, what is it about? It's a long passage. In the first few lines, you have to understand what is it talking about. You don't have to read the entire passage to understand. The first paragraph itself should indicate to you. Okay, what is it about? Okay, since we do not have time, I'm telling this. Okay, someone is typing. I'm waiting. Okay, so you guys are answering. It's about minority-owned businesses. This is clearly based in US. It is about the blacks and other minorities that are in US and the businesses and the kind of difficulties they are facing. All right, first you have to get that. Okay. The primary purpose of the passage is to. Very good. Very good. Why is it not A? In 22, why is it not A? Because it's said commonplace. It is not a commonplace idea. What is commonplace? It is usual, mundane, routine. This is not a good routine thing, right? So this is wrong. And this one is correct. All of you are right. Yes. Every word is important, especially in the options. Every word is important. The passage supplies information that would answer which of the following questions. So, in the 23rd one, they are giving you questions. So passage has to have answers to these questions. One of the questions will have answers in this passage. Which of the questions will have answers in the passage? That's what they are asking. What federal agencies have set percentage goals for the use of minority-owned businesses in the public works contract? Did they mention any particular federal agencies? I underlined it. They said some. Where is it? Some. Or. Yes, some are local agencies. So that's not the one. They did not mention any specific federal agency. Okay, this is not the answer. I'm just explaining each question because this question type is different, guys. The passage supplies information that would answer which of the following question. This is a very different kind of question. You should know that. So they will give you questions, and one of the questions will have to have answer in the passage. Okay. The second one, to which business government agencies must business that were awarded federal contracts report their efforts to find minority subcontract? To which government agencies? Did they mention any particular government agencies? They just said Congress. That's it. They did not mention any government agencies. No, this is not the one. How widespread is the use of minority-owned concerns as friends by white backers seeking to obtain subcontracts? Yes, D is the answer. We'll see why. See, they mentioned whites using blacks as a friends in the business, but they did not mention how widespread it is, right? They asked like how widespread. This is not the answer. What is one set of conditions under which a small business might find itself financially or extended? This one is correct. So can you tell me the answer? Like you can find the answer like overextended. That one will be there in the passage. Overextending themselves financially, I can mention. I think you can go there, right? So that is like different kind of question. Do not you have to get used to that. Okay. 24. According to the passage, civil rights activists maintain that one disadvantage under which the minority-owned businesses have traditionally had to labor is that they have difficulty like being especially vulnerable to government and mismanagement of the economy. No, they did not mention that. Being denied bank loans rates comparable to those afforded larger competitors. This could be an answer. No, we'll see the rest of the ones. Not had sufficient opportunity to secure business credit by large corporations. This also could be the answer. We will have to choose between B and C. Not being able to advertise in those. No, this is not the answer. This is advertising is not the correct one. So which one? They have been denied bank loans. No, they haven't mentioned any particular bank loans. So this seems to be the better answer. Not had sufficient opportunity. They are not given any sufficient opportunity to secure any business loans or credit. Okay, this is the one. The passage suggests the failure of a large corporate, large business to have its bids for subcontracts results quickly in orders might cause two. So, what is it talking about? It is talking about large business. The large business to have its bids for subcontracts result quickly in order might cause it to. The experience frustration, but not serious. So when a large corp business fails, what happens? It's not such like whatever. If it fails in the bids of subcontracts, it's not a huge blow to that. If it happens to small business, but it's a huge blow. Correct? So the 25 is when experience frustration but not serious financial threat. If it is about a small finance, a small business, it will be very huge impact. It will be impacted badly. The author implies, okay, no doubt in that, right? I'm moving on. The author implies that a minority-owned business or own concern that does the greater part of its business with one large corporate customer should. So the author, what does the author imply? The minority and the other whites, they have to collaborate, right? We'll see the options. Avoid competition with larger, more established concern by not expanding, not true. Concentrate on securing even more business from the corporation. They did not try to expand its customer base to avoid becoming dependent on the corporation. This seems like one. Yeah. What is the answer? Which one? Since you have given too many answers, you have reached 28. I have not seen the answer. Good. Consider securing even more business from the other corporation. They are not asking you to expand. Try to expand its customer base to avoid becoming dependent. It's clearly mentioned. I think underlined like this. Yeah, I'm underlined, right? So try not to become dependent. This is right. Pass on some work to be done for corporation. Not really. This is not correct. Okay. The next one. It can be inferred from the passage that compared with the requirements of the law, the percentage goals set by the federal and local agencies are. Can you like, they even mentioned, I think I underlined this one also. Yeah. Okay, this one. The federal and local agencies have gone so far to set specific percentage goals for apportioning. This one. More specific. Correct? Okay. Which of the following would most weaken the author's assertion that in 1970s corporate response to federal requirement was substantial? 28. Can someone repeat 28? I haven't seen. I think this is an important question. I want to see how many of you, since you do the quant also, you should be able to answer this. Okay, what is this like? This, which of the following, if true, would most weaken the author's assertion in the 1970s corporate response to federal requirement was substantial? So, what would weaken the author's assertion? Whatever they are saying that happened in 1970 corporate response to federal requirement, what would make it weaker? His response. Okay. So, which one would make it weaker? This is like a hypothetical inferring question. This is not a direct question. You can't just go into the passage and look for the answer. The corporate contracts with minority-owned business related. See, this is more like, I will answer, this is important. D is the answer. Why? For example, I'll just tell you why. Well, of course, you know this. You are CAT aspirants. You should know this. For example, in a subject, in a 70, you get 70 out of 70. 75 out of 75. Someone else gets 75 out of 100. You can't, 78 out of 100. The 78 gone person, you can't just say that I got 78, you just got 75. You got 75 out of 75. You got the full marks. They just got like 78 out of 100. Okay. So that's the important part here. The 1.1 billion represented same as the percentage of total corporate spending in the 1977 as did 77 million in the 1772. They can't be represented as the same. They are not same. Okay. That would weaken the assertion. Okay. Since you also do the quant, I think you understand the question. The author would most likely agree with which of the following statements about corporate response to working with minority subcontractors? Can you again answer this? I haven't seen. Okay. 20, Arjun says 28A. Rest of you, can you again answer? I think this is the last one, right? Last one, guys. So, see, we know corporates are happy. We know for a fact corporates are happy with the collaboration. But of course, they're using the minorities to expand their business. But we know. Correct? So, by that, you do that. Read the rest of the questions. For example, and not by the proliferation of the front organizations, corporations are likely to reduce their efforts and work with minority-owned subcontractors. Then, no. This is your clue. This is your clue. This is wrong. Annoyed by the proliferation of the front organizations? This is wrong. Okay? No, why do you think the A is the answer? Why do you think so? Annoyed by the proliferation of the front organization, corporations are likely to reduce their effort. They are making the minorities the front, guys. They are not annoyed by the front thing. Right? Although corporations showed considerable interest in working with minority businesses, yes. In the 1970s, the aversion to the government paperwork. Aversion to the government paperwork. Did it mention? No, not really. The significant response to corporations in the 1970s likely to be sustained, conceivably increased throughout the 1980s. This can be an answer. They are considerably happy with the collaboration. Okay, let's see the next one also. Although corporations are eager to cooperate with the minority-owned businesses, a shortage of capital in the 1970s made substantial response impossible. They did not mention any shortage of capital. They did not. Okay, you have to go through the passage again. This is the right one. Why the significant response of the corporations in 1970s is likely to be sustained. So basically they are eager to work, and then that happiness or the eager to work with enthusiasm can sustain through the year. That can we can infer. If the minorities can be frustrated with how they are being used, but the majority, that is the whites, are quite happy. Okay, they are sustained. They can be increased throughout. Like, it can be increased. It is the possible answer, because others, they did not mention any capital. They did not mention any aversion to the government work. Okay, these are your clues. Okay, the clues that they are not the answers.